I am Jim Collison, and live from the Gallup campus here in Omaha, Nebraska, this is Gallup's Theme Thursday, recorded on March 27th, 2014. Theme Thursday is a new series as we dive deep into the Clifton Strengths Finder themes one at a time. Today's theme is deliberative. If you'd like to live tweet during the show, the webcast today, you can use hashtag CSFChat, all one word, hashtag CSFChat, and I'll be monitoring Twitter as well during the show. If you have questions, comments, or contributions, we do have a live chat room available. That's really the best way to get your questions in to the program. It's right below the video window. Or if you're listening to the recorded version, you can email them to us at coaching@gallup.com. And don't forget to visit the Gallup Strength Center. Just gallupstrengthcenter.com for all your coaching resources and strengths enthusiast resources as well. You can also catch the video, both streaming and downloadable audio now for offline listening to past webcasts over at coaching.gallup.com. Today with us today, let me just quick introduce our guest. Of course, you might know him if you watch Call to Coach, is Jeremy Petrosini. Jeremy works as a learning and development consultant here at Gallup on the riverfront with me and is coming to us live from Colorado Springs. Jeremy, welcome.
Thanks, Jim. Yeah, glad to be here.
Good, Jeremy. We did experience a little bit of latency there, so just to make you aware of that as well. So we'll keep working on that. Diane Christian is also with us. She's a Gallup Certified Strengths Coach, lives in Raleigh, North Carolina. Diane, welcome.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
Great to have you. And, of course, Kurt Liesfeld is our host today. Kurt works as an advanced learning and development consultant with Gallup here on the riverfront. And, Kurt, it's always great to see you, and welcome to another Theme Thursday.
Hey, thanks a lot, Jim, and thanks for getting this up and running again. We couldn't do this without you. I would just want to say hello to all the people who might be listening to this live or listening to the recorded version, and just a reminder why we're doing these kind of Theme Thursdays is I often say this in the programs where I teach, that if you're going to coach, you have to love all 34 themes. And if you not only have to love it yourself, you sometimes have to help the people who have these themes love them, because if people don't love their themes, they're not gonna live them. And so we want to help build the love for all 34 themes. There's a song that I remember. I'm older back. I think it might have been the Everly Brothers that sang this song. To know you is to love you. And so we want to kind of help you know more about these themes so that you love them a little more. And today's theme is a theme that it's deliberative. Last week we did Activator. We talked about the movers and the shakers, the people who are anxious to get started, people who have got this and this urgency, this need for speed. And today we're going to slow things down a little bit. And it's interesting to me. I think we live in a world that this is just my opinion. I don't have any data about this. But my observation is that we live in a world that appreciates speed more than slowing things down. Acceleration seems to be more important and valuable than deceleration. But what we know is that some people have been successful because they really have been able to know how to slow things down. So we're going to talk about deliberative. I'm going to just talk and try to pull everything out of my brain that's in there about deliberative, and then we're going to get Diane on the into the conversation, and Jeremy will kind of moderate a conversation about, because that's one of her signature themes. She's a person that has deliberative. So here's how I would kind of summarize some of the key points about deliberative. First of all, these are people who are aware of and sensitive to risk. I think that's at the core of it. They can tell when something has the possibility of going wrong. And I think that sensitivity and awareness to risk is one of the things that causes them to be very careful about making decisions. I want to make sure I make the right decision, because if I make the wrong decision, there might be some consequences. And so these are often people who are very careful decision makers. It's also people who really many times choose to think before they talk. I've observed that when you have a deliberative person in a group, initially in the group, they are going to be more of an observer of the group than the participant. They want to kind of check the lay of the land here. What are some of the risks that are inherent just inside of this group? And finally, I think one of the things that the effect of people who have this kind of awareness and sensitivity to risk is they are often very good listeners. they really observe what's going on around them, and they're very careful to tune into things in that particular way. So at the core of it, I think, though, is primarily this awareness of potential problems and potential risks, and trying to actually, the word, a key word, I think, for deliberative is prevention. If I had to contrast that with activator, it would be promotion. Activators are about promotion, getting things moving, getting things started. But people with a deliberative are often very good at that. They want to prevent bad things from happening, and that might sound kind of negative, but I think there. I was thinking about this theme within a context of a role, and I've done some writing about themes and roles, and I wrote about what does deliberative look like in a could deliberative look like in a parent, and here's what I wrote about a deliberative parent. My careful vigilance keeps my child out of harm's way and ultimately prevents their unnecessary pain and sorrow. Now, I think that sounds like a good parent. They're interested in the safety and security of their children, and they are vigilant. Now, obviously, a parent could take that too far. But there are some basic safety and security issues that parents need to be aware of. And that I think the deliberative parent, it's one of the things that they might do very well. I also wrote something, I've done some writing about aiming your themes at your spouse, and that doesn't mean hitting them over the head with your theme, but it means how could you use your theme to be a great spouse, and this is what a deliberative spouse might sound like. There are always threats to intimacy. With vigilance and care, I will guard our love and prevent its corrosion and erosion. And so I hope that kind of gives you a picture of what deliberative could look like within the context of a role. In terms of the domains that we have, the executing, influencing, relationship building, and strategic thinking, deliberative falls in the executing domain because it's really about how do we make decisions and how do we decide what to do, and it really falls in that level. But I find that it is similar in many ways to strategic. Strategic people are very good at kind of considering the possibilities, future possibilities. I think when you use this word, the ability to anticipate and imagine risk, I think that involves some thinking as well. That happens. These are not real things yet, so it really involves thinking as well. So I think, to some degree, it could fit in that thinking, strategic thinking domain as well. Sometimes it's helpful for people to have words to apply to themes, and these are just some words that I think come to mind when I think about deliberative. Caution, problem preventer, risk reducer. I think security is an important deliberative word. Safety, listener, conscientious, restraint, vigilant, guarded, sensible, serious, private. Those are all different words that could help to explain what that deliberative, and these are, I think, good words. The basement of deliberative, and this is how sometimes deliberative can be perceived in a more negative way by those who don't have it, or it might actually, when it's raw, kind of exhibit itself this way, is they might be seen as slow and indecisive. Remember, these are people who don't want to make a snap judgment or make a premature decision, so they think things through. It takes time. So they might be labeled in that way. Some metaphors or sayings that might kind of capture the essence of deliberative is haste makes waste, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, and I think a jury is a good kind of illustration of what deliberation is. A jury deliberates. They want to hear all the testimony, gather all the facts before they come to a judgment. And then, of course, we've talked about accelerator or activator as the accelerator. Deliberative would be the brake. And I often say, I want to have a car that has both of those. And usually, you don't find a person that has both of those. Occasionally, you'll find someone that has both high activator and high deliberative, but in most cases, people have a more developed accelerator or a developed brake. I also want to just say a little bit, and then I'm going to stop here and get some time for some dialogue here. What does raw deliberative look like as compared to more mature deliberative? And I've done some writing about this to try to think about what raw deliberative, what raw themes look like when compared to more mature themes. And here's how I have said this, and this may not be perfect, but it may be a way to kind of help us get some idea. Raw deliberative looks like this. I am cautious because I scare easily. And I think it has to do with the sensitivity to risk. I notice dangerous things to some degree before other people do. And so at its raw form, it could be people that are kind of scared quite easily. Here's what I think it looks like in its more mature form. I am cautious because I care deeply. I think it's people who use their caution to protect, to defend, to guard, secure things that are important and valuable. I mean, to some degree, when you think about the kind of security that we go through as we travel now after 9/11, the process, that is kind of a deliberative process. And as someone who travels frequently, sometimes that bugs me. Sometimes it annoys me, but I know ultimately it has probably saved lives. It is worth the slowing down the boarding process so that we can all get on an airplane and feel safe. So that's kind of just a bunch of information about my deliberative. So Jeremy, let's talk to Diane about this and see what this looks like in living color in a real person.
Yeah, I think something you always say, Kurt, which I think is critical, is, you know, themes like picking out a name for your kid. You know, none of us want to name our child the name of the person we didn't like from high school, right? So, and these 34 themes sometimes have biases. Or I was with somebody a couple days ago. He's a CEO. He realized he had adaptability 34, and he said that's why that person on my team with adaptability number one. He's like, I just don't get it. And so I think you're absolutely right. It was fun to hear last time about activators and how they really help us get things going. And deliberative, you know, it's always great to just see what does that look like in action. So, Diane, I'm glad you're with us. I know you've been a fan of strengths and a coach for over a decade. Use that in your background in banking and now as an independent consultant helping leaders, organizations everywhere. But glad to have you here. Tell us a little bit, and Kurt, I'll let you keep kind of driving dialogue, but tell us a little bit about what deliberative looks like in action.
Well, you know, it's been very interesting to listen to what Kurt had to say. Some of it I'd heard before, some of it was new, and I was completely comfortable just sitting here listening, taking notes and thinking, oh my gosh, I have more to think about, but I can't think now, I've got to talk. So I'm shaking myself back into the present, but it was great, Kurt, thank you.
And which, Diane, that's the opposite of our last call where our activator friend sat there going, let me say something, right?
Yeah, I know you were all worried that I wouldn't get to talk soon enough, and I'm like, I'll talk, I'm fine whenever I talk. So as I think about deliberative over the last 13, I think I've known I've had deliberative for 13 years now. So when I first, I mean, deliberative isn't exactly a glamorous title or a glamorous description, but I tell you what I've come to love is that I'm a serious decision maker. If someone would say, Diane, what I like about you most is you're a serious decision maker, I'd feel like I'd made an impact. I like being a serious decision maker. And I kind of like being the brake. I don't mind slowing things down. What I don't like, and I think this was earlier in my career and more in the raw state, is when I was cautious, because I was scared. I can remember those situations, and I'll tell you about one of them. But I feel like now, I think why I've embraced deliberative so much more is because I'm cautious because I really care, and I'm mature enough to just say, you know, I care about this is important. Do we really want to go there? And the situation, I actually worked with an activator, and I don't mean this to be an activator basher, because I appreciate people with activator, certainly, just don't activate too fast. give me a chance to think. And there was a decision to try to overhaul a major incentive plan, and the minute I heard what he was thinking of doing, and I knew he could make it happen, and I thought about the number of employees it would impact, I had all the reasons why this wouldn't work, and I think I showed how scared I was, instead of like, I care about this, how can we do this? So I don't think that I was as successful as I have been in later years, not being scared about it. So that was a great analogy that you did, Kurt.
Yeah, I like the way that you said that, though. I mean, you know, expressing your scare or expressing your care. And I think a more mature way to do that is certainly that.
I'd have to admit, though, I've probably lapsed back into a raw form periodically, but I feel like it's more mature. I have an example that I think it's more from my personal life that I thought would be helpful to share. I had recently, is that all right to go ahead with that?
Absolutely.
So I had recently done a major overhaul of our kitchen, and I got a little, there was something else that could be done. So I decided I was going to have an island put in, and I thought about, is it going to be an accent island, or is it going to match island? There's all these new things to do, and I didn't really have the recommended 3 feet clearance from the dishwasher opening, the freezer door opening, the oven door opening. I only had like 2.5 feet. So I took blue painter's tape and put it exactly on the floor. And I even left it down while other people came to visit, and I'd say, what do you think? Do you think this will be? I mean, I walked around this blue invisible, or around the blue tape that was the invisible island for probably 4 weeks to make sure that I wasn't going to invest this money, which is not inexpensive to do a granite top island. And I'm glad I waited, because I got to the point, I looked at it from every angle in the kitchen, at the kitchen table, at the sink, at the door, at the other door. Maybe other people thought, just make a decision. Well, I was working on it. Well, the island is in. It's absolutely gorgeous. I even thought about what bowl I was going to put on top of it for the fruit to make sure I had the right bowl. I mean, it's a fun process for me. But for someone else to see it, they might think, wow, she's doing a lot of thinking about this. But it's because it's important to me. And I don't know that I've done projects that didn't turn out, but it seems like the more time I spent thinking about something that's an investment, if you will, the better off it turns out. So I really embrace it.
Can I jump in on that? Because I think that's an important distinction about deliberative. I mean, you had somebody who probably said to you, we don't think this will work. You don't have the right clearance. They were saying no.
Yeah.
And you said wait. Wait does not always mean no, because your wait said you waited, you kind of thought about it, you kind of, you know, actually put tape, will this work? You decided yes. Sometimes I think people assume that wait means no, but that's a great example of where wait means yes when someone else is saying no.
Yeah, and I find if someone pushes me, and it more when I was probably in more of a corporate environment, I would just reserve more time to think, because I know I could get to a place more than likely to support something that was happening in the corporation. I just needed to have enough time to reduce the risk. I think, Kurt, when your cards came out, the theme cards, and I read those and read that it was about reducing the risk, I'm like, I'll do that every day. Who wouldn't want to reduce the risk, you know, in my mind? And I realize that not everybody needs to. I need to.
How have you gotten more time? How do you ask for more time, or how do you get more time from people when you need it?
Well, if it's real, like with the person that I wasn't quite successful with, I had a pretty major commute. I would just think about, I mean, just thinking about it and doing kind of a pro con in my mind, like how can I get the risk down? Because okay. It's all about getting the risk down. It's not about not doing it. And the thing also I've noticed about myself, and also my son has deliberative. And I love it in him. I love it I love him, but I love it in him as well.
Good.
Yeah, exactly. Is, you know, just the time to think. So you just make it, it's important, so you make the time to think about it. So with the person at work, I would just think about it, you know, write things down. And I tried really hard not to make him think I wasn't going to be able to support him, but I kept trying to put the brakes on a little bit.
You know, one of the things that we talk about great managers is that they're able to individualize their approach to their employees and helping people get what they need. And I think one of the things that some people need is a little more time. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, I don't think we have unlimited that we can give people, but if a manager could give a person with deliberative a little more time, maybe if they would say, you know what, we're going to be talking about this topic at our meeting today, and if you give them an advance warning about that, it gives them some time ahead of time to think through it.
Well, and you know, I told you the example about my son when he was a very young child.
Yeah, tell that story. Yeah.
Yeah, because I think I learned a whole lot then, and this was prior to him taking the Strength Finder, but he had gotten some money and we were at Toys R Us and he was in the aisle and I remember watching him trying to make a decision about what toy to buy. I mean, this was like a major decision for him. And I'd reached my limit and I came down and said, Adam, now, right, we're leaving in 5 minutes, you have to make a decision. And I watched him, it wasn't an effective way to work with him. And what, 15, 20 years later, I learned that he has deliberative, and pushing someone with deliberative to make a decision before they're ready is just a mistake. So, yeah. Because I can remember the expression on his face when I was rushing him. And I think I mentioned he has three lovely daughters and a beautiful wife. And I love how deliberative he is with all of their financial, spiritual, where they live decisions. He's just a careful decision maker, and I absolutely love it. And now give him much more time.
Diane, how about in situations where you have to move a little bit faster? What speeds you up, or where do you go to speed up a little bit if you have to?
Yeah, I think that's when I start to seek others' thoughts around it. And if we go back to my island, many people walked in and I had them just look at it. What do you think? And I have some people that I really trust. My son-in-law and daughter both are real estate agents. And I'm like, okay, what do you think about this? Will this increase the value of our home or not? So I kind of got their buy-in. So people that are smarter than me about stuff, just to, you know, get reinforcement or not.
So trusted advisors can speed you up. If they say yes, you might move a little bit quicker if they kind of give their blessing.
Well, you know, yes and no. I mean, I still think about, it comes down to, I'm still going to make the final decision. Uh-huh. I get that so clearly, but it's input that I'm willing to take. And again, that input just reduces or raises the risk.
Tell us your other four signature themes here, just so we can think about how they might interact with each other.
Focus. When I was in that toy aisle with Adam, it was really focus that had kicked in.
Okay.
We're leaving it 5 minutes.
Focus speeds you up a bit. Okay. Yeah.
Oh yes, it does. ideation.
Okay.
And I do have lots of ideas, and so I think the deliberative enhances the idea. So all my ideas don't get implemented, just the good ones.
Uh-huh, yeah.
Input and significance.
Okay, input. I like the relationship between ideas and ideation and deliberation, because ideation by design is somewhat risky.
Yeah.
It's because this is something new. It's innovation. This hasn't. We don't know exactly what's going to happen. So there's some uncertainty about this. So how does tell a little about how your deliberative makes your ideation better?
Well, I remember when I first moved to the corporate headquarters of this bank I was working with and working at, I would spout out all these things and people would look at me like I was crazy. And then when I got involved with StrengthsFinder and I realized that all my ideas aren't good, so hold back on the ideation, especially when you're trying to be innovative, because that I could lose a lot of credibility if I spouted off all my ideas. So the deliberative enhanced the holding back of the ideas.
Yeah, when I hear you use that phrase, holding back, that's the word that I think is that is restraint.
Yes.
Showing restraint.
Yes.
That's what deliberative is. Kind of when people get really smart about this, it's knowing when to talk and when not to talk. When to bring an idea, when to not.
Right.
It's that restraint mechanism that I think helps to kind of sort.
Yeah.
But I do like the idea. I think people with deliberative need to think about what speeds them up and that focus, you know,
yeah.
The goal, I've got someplace to be. So that's that can speed you up. So if I need to be speeded up, that's where you can go.
Well, and back to the island, I hate to keep going back to it, but it's such a recent thing. You know, all the work was to happen while I was gone out of town working. And so when I come home, it was supposed to be done. So, you know, it's like once I decide that the project's going to happen,
I see.
We're going fast.
So and, deliberative precedes focus, and once focus kicks in.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's almost like ideation first, you know, the ideation happens, and even the input seeking others' thoughts and opinions, and then the deliberative, then the focus. Yeah.
I think that's a great, because sometimes I think we judge people kind of wrongly, but especially when we think about one theme at a time, and that word slow. Diane is slow. I mean, you're slow in certain situations and certain times, but as you said, once I decide, that's when an accelerator goes down. I don't know where the accelerator comes from, but it's, okay, now I want to get this goal accomplished. I want to get the island done.
Well, it's like I take my foot off the brake because there's no need to brake anymore.
Yeah, all the risk has been managed.
Yeah, and it's time to put my foot on the gas and let's go. And I think that's confusing sometimes for people. And also, when I do a lot of, I teach in a coaching program, and, go ahead.
No, finish, Diane, go ahead.
Oh, I was just thinking I teach a lot of people to be coaches, and I have a lot of opportunity to give feedback. And I always have a lot, I listen to them coach or whatever, and I have a lot to say to them, and I always have opportunities for them. Because restorative is number 6 for me. So I have ideas. And what I've learned over the years with the coaching from Kurt and others is hold back, restrain. You don't have to say everything that you hear or think about. There's plenty of time to have this conversation. So let's start with the good stuff. And and I always tell people, I'll tell you what I'm thinking, but I want to hear what you think first.
That's great. Go ahead, Jeremy.
Yeah, I was just going to say that the thing I hear too and I've learned to appreciate with people that are deliberative is it's not caution just for sake of being cautious, but it leads to excellence. And again, that's spoken. I know, Kurt, you know I'm maximizer number one, so spoken like a true maximizer. But, Diane, there were no worries for you when you were gone about where the island was going to end up or what it was going to be like.
Oh, no.
Because you had already spent 6 weeks making sure it was right. And I think that's one of the things I really appreciate about deliberative. I'm in Colorado Springs leading a high performance management course. Mm-hmm. And one of the leaders said, I love all the questions you're asking, but I'm not shy. I just don't want to answer and for my answers to be wrong and wrong to me, because he said, I'll think about it over lunch and want to change my answer. And he said, I just want to get it right. And so my caution is not about being slow. Now, he also has intellection high, and Jim, I know there was a question out there about thinking slow versus acting slow, which we'll let you guys hit on, but I think it really is about accuracy and getting it right. I think of people in legal departments that have deliberative, I'm glad they're asking questions. I'm glad they're hitting the brakes, slowing it down, because it saves us all headache in the long run. So, Jim, are there other questions? I know there are a couple out there in chat that I'd love for Diane and Kurt to be able to expand on.
Yeah, let me bring these in. I want to combine two together. So these were early in the program, Chris and guest 404. So Chris asks, what is the likely characteristic of a deliberative person that might be considered negative in a leadership situation? So hold that thought, negative in a leadership situation. And then guest 404 says, I love my deliberative, but others often view my gift of anticipating obstacles/risks as pessimism. I view my abilities as contributions to making things run more smoothly and efficiently. I am frustrated by the pessimistic label. So let me say, I think maybe that pessimistic label might be one of those items. But how do you guys want to answer those?
Well, I can answer the one about the first one was about a leader that has deliberative. How that could be a I think any theme can have a. A barrier to it. It has to be productively applied, and I think that's the challenge with anything. How can I use this to make things better? And that doesn't mean immediately better. I think with deliberative, it means ultimately better. And for Diane, she wanted that island ultimately to be in the right spot, and she wanted it to be in a way that she could walk around. So she slowed down things in the present so that the future might be better. And I think to some degree, there's a great book called The Contrarian Leader by Steve Sample, who was the president of USC. I think he had deliberative. I'm guessing he did. He talks about sometimes great leaders don't overreact, they underreact. I think that's a kind of a deliberative approach to leadership. Not all leaders are successful because they, you know, the early bird gets the worm. Sometimes great leaders are great because, here's one of these phrases, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. You know, and sometimes it's about money. We can, if we do a little bit now, if we think a little longer, we might prevent problems that cost lots of money if we think a little bit more ahead. How about pessimism and deliberative, Diane? Can you answer that question? How do you manage the perception that you might be a negative person because of the you got your feet dragging sometimes?
Yeah, and I think what I'm thinking about is not looking scared. So having the confidence that just says, you know, what we need to do, what I need to do is think about this some more. I want to look at all aspects of this. I really want to make a great decision because of these. So explaining the slowdown, if you will. I think probably early in my career, I was probably thought of as pessimistic. And that took some growth and development. And because that would be horrible for me, for anyone to think I'm pessimistic. And I think falling into the whole strength movement probably helps my deliberative a whole lot to look more mature. Because I'm looking for what's right first. But in my mind, I'm always going through the obstacles. It's there. So I think explaining to people what you're doing.
Yeah, I've been able to interact with you for a number of years here, and I really don't perceive you as a negative person. I mean, you got a great smile. Part of it is, I think, how you deliver the news. And you don't look scared. You look happy. And I think that phrase, it's not that I'm scared, it's because I care. I think if people with deliberative can kind of think through that a bit, what do I really care about here? Am I just afraid? Or is there something truly at risk here? Do I know what it is? And can I communicate that to others?
Well, and when I'm coaching coaches, the last thing I want them to do is be scared of what I'm going to say. I want them to come to me fully authentic and let's talk through it. I may give you, you can guarantee I'm going to give you some feedback that you might want to think about, but I don't want to knock you off your feet by saying, well, you know, you didn't do this well, you didn't do that well, or anything like that. So, you know, my significance, as you've pointed out to me many times, doesn't let me go to the pessimistic too much.
Yeah.
One of the comments from the chat room I found interesting from Mike, he says, deliberative equals due diligence.
Yeah, good.
That's another great word. Thank you, Mike. Yeah, we get those kind of words. If any of you come up with words, I just find that words and phrases are so critical to coaching people, and that word's going to work for somebody, Mike. It explains it in a positive light, doing due diligence. There's stuff you got to think about in advance. There's stuff you got to work through to kind of get to the right place.
Let me throw a question in here from David. He says, thanks for the comparison to strategic, which, Kurt, I think you made earlier. I have both strategic and deliberative. Mm-hmm. I still can't see why deliberative is under the executing, you know, the major column of executing. Seems like it was under the thinking domain in the original publication following that, which was following this path. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think that the original follow this path was more of a conceptual arrangement of these themes. The latest version of this was really a statistical compilation of these, mapping of these themes to these domains. And it really is more, it was really done within the context of studying senior leaders. And I know many times people apply these things more broadly to people in all different kinds of roles, but it really, when we study senior leaders, deliberative seems to be closer to the, to almost to the front lines, the action, and where dangerous things happen to some degree.
And, you know, I have a thought about that, too, when you said that, because I'm real aware of once the risk is reduced, I go very quickly. And I think about a situation I had with an employee, which I was really being careful with, that wasn't a good fit in the organization, and tried to work with him beyond what everybody else thought we should do. And finally, one day, I said, that's it. We're done. And, you know, it seemed like, he was like, where'd that come from? Well, we've been talking about this for 6 weeks. In my mind, I've reduced the risk. It's not going to work for you to stay working here. It's time for you to go ahead and seek for other employment. So it's like, it is fast. Once the risk is reduced, it is about executing and getting it done.
Yeah, that's good to hear. That's a learning for me. Thank you.
Yeah.
Let me jump to a question real quick, because I think this dovetails right in with what you're talking about, and I'm skip ahead on the questions, but they're talking about it in the chat room right now. Guest 392, by the way, guests, so you guys can't put your names in. Guest 392 says, how effective is a deliberative leader to operate in a chaotic environment where decisions need to be made instantly without much time from the business?
Yeah, I mean, that would not sound like a great fit. Now, sometimes we assume that an environment is the way it has to be, and sometimes it is, but sometimes people use culture and environment, and that assumes that culture is always good and the way it ought to be. Sometimes a culture might be better if it slowed down a little bit, if we could bring a little more understanding to this world. But obviously, if this is about immediate decisions, I don't know, Diane, have you ever been in a situation where you felt like you had to decide immediately about everything?
No, but I remember interviewing in a hospital. I was in marketing at the time, and I interviewed at a hospital and a bank, and I went home to think about it, and I thought, there is no way I'm going to work in a hospital and walk down the hall and someone's going to expect me to do something, because I'm not going to be able to do anything. I'm not trained that way. It was such a risk for me to go work in a hospital.
Okay, yeah, there's kind of an immediacy there, yeah.
Well, yeah, like there's patients that I couldn't delineate that I would just not, I would only be responsible for marketing in the hospital.
Uh-huh.
So yeah. I didn't put myself in that situation, and yeah. I never understood that until now.
But can't you get around that by some predefined actions? So if you know you're going to get tripped up in those situations, that you think about your response in advance and say, okay, I'm going to think through these, and when these, because, you know, there's only so many variations, even in chaos, right? There's still only so many variations of things that can happen. Can you kind of pre-think those actions out and then act upon them when those situations happen?
It could be that experience helps you deal. If you keep going through the same kind of chaos, you might learn some things about how to manage it and how to live with that and how to make decisions a little bit faster. But I just think environments where immediate decisions are necessary, a deliberative person, and obviously that's just one theme, they might have activator in their top five, that might differ, but that theme itself probably is not going to thrive in that kind of environment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right.
Okay, let me move on to another question. So Judy asked this question, then how is deliberative different than intellection?
I think it's really the sensitivity and awareness to risk that really delineate. I think people with intellection think. I mean, they really think deeply. I think they mm-hmm. have some things in common, actually. I think they both need time to think. But I think the focus of the thinking of deliberative is maybe more specific. Intellection really is not necessarily focused primarily on risk. It could be thinking about philosophical things. It may be a concept people want to think deeply about. So I think that's the differentiation. Both are thinking themes. One is more thinking about risk, whereas the other is more general deep thinking.
And just to add to that, for me at least, as I think about intellection and deliberative, I mean, deliberative, reducing the risk is to get to action. It's not just to think about it.
Yeah.
For me, it's like I've got to have the thinking to get the risk down, and once it's down, I'm into action. I'm into executing.
Yeah, I like the connection that you're making there. That really helps people. This is not just about inaction. This is not just about doing. It is a prelude to action.
Right, yeah.
That's a great way to think about that.
Bill has a question. He says, I have deliberation number one, a deliberative number one, and achiever number five. Sometimes I feel that they are at odds, and I feel an internal impatient conflict with myself as well as I am making decisions. How can I improve upon this?
Well, first of all, I would say stop thinking about it as a conflict. There's a tension. I think there is an inner tension that I think themes that are more paradoxical kind of create in a person. And in a sense, I like the way that Diane talked about how her deliberative and her focus, even though they're different, they make each one better. You know, how when I think something through, then the focus comes. But I think there's probably a tension between those two, or maybe at one point there was. You seem to have kind of compartmentalized those pretty good. You know when to be deliberative. You know when to become focused. And I think there is a sophistication that comes when we figure out, okay, when is it time for me to be deliberative? When is it time for me to get stuff done? So how do I make those two live together? And I didn't hear the other theme.
Achiever.
Achiever and deliberative, yeah. So I think it's learning to kind of live with the tension and figure out how to. It's a little bit about timing. There's a time to be careful, and there's a time to get things done. And,
Jim,
and you've got both of those.
And Jim, what was the third? Was there a third theme that he mentioned, Bill mentioned?
No, deliberative number one, achiever number five.
Oh, okay, five. Well, you know, Kurt's done a lot of work about pairing up themes, and I've taken that on with a lot of. Once I figured out it was really good, I reduced the risk that this wasn't good stuff. That it was really good stuff. I used it all the time, and I love to pair up the strengths. So achiever with deliberative, that probably looks like getting a lot done, and getting a lot of. And I don't know if you can read that.
I can read this here. Here's how I kind of marry deliberative to achiever. When I work with intensity and stamina, I don't want my work to be hurried. Working in haste can lead to waste. So I think what it means is that your work, your achievement is better if you can do it in an unhurried manner. And so again, are you in an environment or do you have a manager or leader that will give you time to work at a slightly less hurried pace? Can we unhurry people a little bit? Obviously, there are time constraints, but I think, could we give people a little more time? I think that's maybe the biggest message for managers who manage people, for parents who parent. Can you give your child a little more time? I think that's the lesson that Diane learned, and I think that's probably something that for those of us who work with people, live with people that have deliberative, one of the biggest gifts we can give them is a little more time.
Yeah, and I think it's also important to look at the themes individually so we really understand them, and we're coaching people that they really understand them. But as soon as you can start to integrate them so that they see them all working together, so I ask people to create a new paragraph with their top five. Take the sentences right out of the reports and have them all work together, because they, in reality, they are working together. They're not separate. And I think you've said this, Jeremy or Kurt, that, you know, they enhance or what was the other word you used?
Temper. Temper, and they can sharpen.
Yes, temper and sharpen. So that achiever can really sharpen the deliberative and vice versa.
Absolutely.
Guys, we are at the 45-minute mark. That goes so fast.
Yeah, so much fun.
I hope it went fast for everybody listening. I know it did for me.
We did not get all the questions in, and that's okay. If I missed your question, I tried to group them or get to them all. If we missed it, we do have a Facebook group where you can continue this conversation. If you just go to facebook.com/groups/calledtocoach, that would be our Facebook page. It is a closed group. Just ask to be put in. I'll approve you this afternoon and get you in there, and you can ask those questions there as well. We all spend some time on that site, and so there's some really good conversations, about 1,500 people out there now answering your questions. And it's not one of the things I've liked about the Facebook group, it's not too loud. Not everybody chimes in on everything. And so it's a good opportunity to pick up on some things. Kurt, any final words as we kind of wrap things up here?
No, I just I hope there's a little more love for deliberative after this conversation, because I think deliberative is a theme that deserves a little more love, because we live in a world that's constantly in a hurry. And I think we probably need the 10% of people that have deliberative in their top five to kind of slow us down a little bit so that we don't get into trouble. And so, Diane, I just am really thankful. I just appreciate so much the way that you've allowed us to get a glimpse of deliberative and living color. And you're a great poster child for deliberative.
Well, thank you. It was fun. I enjoyed it.
And likewise, you know, we talked about activator, and I'm a high activator and a high mover, and I learned a lot from you guys as well this week. So good as we work through those themes, and I really appreciate the both of you coming out today to spend some time doing this. We do want to remind everyone to take full advantage of all the resources we have available. Really, the hub for everything we're doing around strengths now is at the Gallup Strengths Center. So GallupStrengthsCenter.com will get you a lot of materials out there. If you've already taken the Strengths Finder, you can log in and get a lot of what you need there. Of course, we're doing a lot around this with the audio and video now, and so if you want to get in touch with that, coaching.gallup.com is the place to be. You might be there right now. If you're not, head over there and look at what we Theme Thursday, Call to Coach, Strength Spotlights, all those are available for you to consume there. We do have a YouTube page, and the link to our YouTube page is out at coaching.gallup.com, as well as our Facebook. Follow Twitter at StrengthsFinder as well, as we continue to grow those social networks. If you have any questions for us, you can send us an email, coaching@gallup.com. If you're wondering, what is this coaching training that we've been talking about as well? In fact, we have 24 coaches today in our training, the accelerated training in Omaha.
They're probably waiting for me to get down there.
I was going to say, well, hopefully they're still watching this far into the program, and I got to say hi to them yesterday, and it was kind of fun. Hopefully all the technology worked out down there so they could watch Theme Thursday live on the big screen, and it's great to have them here. But you can send us an email, coaching@gallup.com. Join our Facebook group and YouTube, and we'll do it all again actually next Friday. Jeremy, we lost Jeremy somewhere in the middle of the conversation. We have Amy Robles coming on Call to Coach next Friday. That is April, and I should have written that down, but next Friday is April 4th, and you can join us at noon Central, 1 p.m. Eastern, as Amy talks about she's got a coaching practice to athletes. And so if you maybe you've been thinking about that, of using strength in athletics, she's got a great story, and there's a lot of great opportunity there. If you want to know everything that's going on around these new webcasts that we're doing, the address you need to know is gallup.eventbrite.com. Everything we're doing is listed out there. You can, when you register, you get signed up for the reminder that we're doing these things, and that way you won't miss a show. But if you do miss one, if you miss a program, it's okay. We record them all for you. They're all available after the fact as well at coaching.gallup.com. Kurt, Diane, and for Jeremy, we say good afternoon and good night or good morning, depending on where you're at in the world. And we thank you for coming out. Have a great day, everybody. Good night.